Hey, welcome back to my channel. Today I would like to expose the biggest lie in my life, which could be the biggest lie in your life as well. I really think it's super important, so hear me out. But before telling you just directly what is the problem, what is the lie, I want you to guess. I want you to play this game with me. So it's the biggest lie in our life, so let's go all the way back to the beginning of our lives. When we were born, we were taken to the nurse station to be evaluated 0 to 10. If we're doing well, we're giving back to our mothers. If we're not doing well, according to 0 to 10 evaluation, we'll be kept by the nurses to receive some treatments. And quickly we grow at 6, 7 years old, we go to school. And then every exam, we will be ranked, at least when I was young, it was like that, against our fellow classmate in the class. And then your parents would know how well you're doing, how talented, how smart you are, or how not smart you are, depending on this class ranking. And quickly you grow, when you are 18 years old, you would go to college. And depending on the SAT, depending on your GPA, you will be given an acceptance letter to the school you want or to a different school, and you would go. And after of 5 years of hard work, you collect enough credits, you will graduate. And when you are standing in the center of the stage with everybody clapping and cheering for you, you receive the graduation paper, the diploma from the dean, and you feel that you're on top of the world. You feel so good, you feel that there will be only success and glory in your life. And at least I feel like that when I was graduating, and I did it 5 times because I was addicted to this feeling. But then you sit back in your seat when your fellow classmates were giving these speeches on the stage, you were browsing on your phone secretly, and you read. According to this BFA, MFA, PhD.com, only 10% of art school graduates will be able to make a full income as an artist. Well, that's outrageous, that's crazy. Like, I'm not even the top 10 in my class, that means I will not become a successful artist. How many years I have worked, how hard I've studied, and now I have this diploma, but guess what? I have just student loan debts to pay back and 10% of chance of making a living. You know, this is the biggest lie in our lives. I guess you have guessed right, numbers. We often say numbers don't lie, but guess what? I think numbers do lie sometimes, and a lot of times too often, because I discovered the maternal death rate was a lie. Because I think that's like the basic things we need to know, like every woman, every man need to know, because if you might die, all this work, all this study, all this hard work to become an artist, and then you give birth to your children and you die. Like, what's the point, right? At least you should know. That's like a human right. And I discovered that was a total lie. And that starts from a dinner. I was sitting on a big dinner and there were some strangers, friends of a friend, and I was small talking with some people, and suddenly there was one guy saying, "Oh, why don't you have children?" I was like, "Oh, did you know that maternal death rate is high? So, you know, it's dangerous to have children." And he was like, "No, no, it's very safe. I work for a very good insurance company. I'm a statistician, or how do you call this? People, you know, evaluate." And he was like, "It's very safe. Trust me. Look at the numbers." And I was like Googling, I look at the Wikipedia, I look at the WHO or WHO, if you may call them. And I look and I was like, "What? This is nonsense." So how would you calculate a death rate of a condition or a disease? Usually you look, for example, lung cancer. You would look at people who died from lung cancer versus people who were diagnosed with lung cancer, so that you see, you have a clear idea of how likely you will die if you're diagnosed with lung cancer, right? But no, maternal death rate is calculated like this. Women who died from childbirth or some things related to the complications of delivering a child versus women who have uterus. Yes, yes, women who have uterus, who are at the childbearing age. For me, this is ridiculous, because that means it's a lot safer, okay, quote unquote safer, because then the death rate is a lot lower, because not every woman would have children at the childbearing age, because like I didn't have children, you see, like I'm just saying, like this data is biased and it's tricking people thinking that it's very safe, right? Why don't you just even say woman versus all the human in this earth? That's even safer for women to give birth. Like, but no, it's not the case. You might actually die giving birth. I'm saying, even if you're a man, you might think, oh, it's so safe because in any case, I will not be affected. Guess what? In my world, if I'm this judge, if I make the laws, if a man's partner gave birth and died from giving birth to his child or his children, he will be penalized to death because it was murder. It was manslaughter. Okay, so now when your life is on the line, do you still feel very safe? That's what I'm trying to say. Like when you think the data is irrelevant, you let it go, you let the data trick some people, more vulnerable people who might not have the knowledge. And this guy from this insurance company who thought he knew everything, but of course it does not concern him. And when his life was not on the line, he was so offline. And I really think this is something we need to think twice about. And the second example I want to give you is called the Simpsons paradox. Not the Simpson yellow kind of figure animation. No. A Simpson is the scientist, is a statistician. I don't know if I pronounce this word right. He developed this theory in 1951, or he discovered this theory, is that when you look at the numbers from a different perspective, from a more insightful angle, you will come to a completely opposite conclusion. So you have the hospital A and hospital B. And look at the hospital A's cure rate is 50%, hospital B's cure rate is 60%. And you may say, oh, B is better because it's 60%, so you know overall it's better. But if you look at how severe is each group of patients, and you may say, oh, look, actually A has better results and hospital B had worse results. But when you average everything out, it's called lurking variable. Look, 10% of chance, according to the national data, that you will become a successful artist, you'll be able to make a full income as a professional artist. But if you look at the data in a totally different way, maybe the 90% of art school graduates didn't even try to become artists because they became designers. They become animators working in Disney, working on the Frozen 5, 6, 7. And they're not successful artists because they're art teachers. It doesn't mean that their lives will be miserable. They will be so like upset. They can have very comfortable, very fulfilling careers without having to become a full-time artist. And maybe they're from a very wealthy family, or they become a housewife or house husband, dedicating their time training their children, taking care of the family, and they don't make a full income, right? They don't even need to make that full income from making art. And the national statistics tell you, you have only 10% chance, but not at all. Maybe you have more chances than you think you have, but you don't know. So if you give up now, you will never know. So I think I really want you to try. If this is what you want to do, don't be stopped by these numbers, these stats, this data that other people tell you. You can collect data on your own as well to have different sources. You look at the national data, you look at the regional data. You look at your school's data, you look at the data around you. You know, collect the data firsthand from your own social circles, or launch a survey on your social media and see how many people are successfully selling their art, right, on Saatchi Art, on Society 6, and have a judgment yourself. Don't listen to the numbers blindly. Don't just rely on, you know, what scientists say. For them, you're just an insignificant denominator. That made me so upset because as a woman myself, it's like, you know, I want to know if I would die or not giving birth, but guess what? The data scientists couldn't care less. That's why we need to have a critical thinking when it comes to important decisions, when it comes to, you know, decisions based on numbers. We cannot let numbers deceive us. We need to use our head, use our heart, use our gut feelings, use Google Analytics, use every sources of information you could use so that you could make a better decision based on your situation And do not let other people deceive you, mislead you, because I believe your decision, your future, your success is in your own hands. If you ask me, should I become a full-time artist? Will my art sell? My answer would be, it depends, but likely yes, because the future is in your hands. You will not be a denominator in some other people's story. Let yourself be the nominator, right? Nominate yourself and do everything you could to boost your success rate in your career path, because I think you have a lot of free will. You have a lot of things, abilities, different qualities, and different numbers you can use to go against the odds and to have a better success. Maybe your small arts would sell, but the big arts that costing $15,000 will never sell, but smaller works or art prints or gadgets would sell better, and you can make more money from selling cheaper works to a different market instead of selling this big art through galleries, art fairs, or on Saatchi Art. I mean, depending on your personal story, depending on your situation, you can come up with the right strategy to boost your success rate. Your future is in your own hands. That's all what I want to say to you in the end of the video. All right, thank you very much for watching. Let me know what you think of the numbers and what numbers did to you. And thank you very much. See you in the next video.